I'm Brother Anthony Roberts, greeting you from the Five Gospel Halls here in Tobago. We are delighted that you've been able to join us for today's program, Moments with Truth. We are praying that as you view this program, that you will receive a blessing from the Lord. For those who are not saved, we are praying very specially that you will receive the Lord Jesus as your Savior, even today, as you hear the Word of God. And for those of you who are saved, it is our prayer that you will be built up on your most holy faith as you view the Word of God.
I want to turn to the Word of God for our first reading this morning, and that will be taken from the book of Luke, the Gospel according to Luke, and chapter 10. I'm beginning to read at verse number 30 of Luke chapter 10. In reply, Jesus said, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he fell into the hands of robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So too a Levite, when he came to the place, he saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan," verse 33, "as he traveled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he put the man on his own donkey and took him to an inn and took care of him. The next day, he took out 2 silver coins and gave them to the innkeeper. 'Look after him,' he said, 'and when I return, I will reimburse you for that any extra expense you may have.' Which of these 3 do you think was neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers?" The expert in the law replied, "The one who had mercy on him." Jesus told him, "Go and do likewise." May the Lord bless us, the reading of his holy word, and any other passages that we are certainly going to look into, for his name and for his mercy's sake. This morning, the message before us, as we have just read those verses, has to do with the actions of a good man. The actions of a good man. In this case, we have read the passage that clearly showed us, if you're following very carefully, that the actions of a good man, as is given in the narrative, has to do with the person who was referred to and called the Samaritan. Samaritan. This man, we see in scriptures, is a type of Christ. He's a type of Christ. And it is startling, you know, when you look in the scriptures and to see the various types that are given there as it relates to the Lord Jesus Christ. But no type is perfect as it relates to the Lord Jesus Christ. They all have flaws because of the fact that men, like ourselves, no matter how good we are tainted by sin. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, was sinless, spotless, and undefiled. We just want to look at the passage in 3 areas. Firstly, we see the condescension, the condescension rather, of the Good Samaritan, the compassion of the Good Samaritan, and also the care of the Good Samaritan. So, the condescension of the Good Samaritan, as we have it in verse 33, we're going to focus our attention mainly upon that particular verse. By way of introduction, the road to Jericho from Jerusalem was infamous for crime and robbery. It wasn't surprising to Jesus' listeners that he set the story on this particular road. Of course, he was responding to this bright young ruler, a man who was versed in the law and so on. And he was asking Jesus some questions, and Jesus was answering him and so on. And then this is where the conversation flowed into, when he gave him this parable about this particular man that was beaten and left half dead. So that this particular road, it was a road that was known to be a road or an area for crime, like a hotspot in our Twin Island states. We have places in Trinidad and Tobago that are referred to as hotspots. We have heard Brother Barry spoke on numerous occasions about carrying heat with you, and it's a very dangerous situation to be in. That road was famous for its lurking dangers. People seldom attempted that road alone. If they carried goods, like valuables and so on, they would seldom go along that road alone. Right? Seeking safety in numbers was a very wise thing to do rather than going along that road by yourself. So they traveled. Most people would travel in convoys, or they travel in caravans, but this was the way in which, you know, they moved in groups long ago. And this man had no one but to blame but himself for the plight in which he found himself, as we have it in the passage that we have looked at. He had no one to blame but himself, because he very well must have known that this was no easy place to traverse by himself, given the experiences of others, and as he himself would have ultimately found out that it was a very unwise move to go down that road, having no doubt taken, you know, valuables and so on along with him. Jericho, going down the road from Jerusalem to Jericho. Not a nice thing to do. Hard place to traverse. This world in which you live is a very hard place to traverse as well. Eh? We are living in dangerous times. The climate is very dangerous. No matter what you do and where you go, you are subjected and you are exposed to dangers of one kind or another. Persons like ourselves, humans like ourselves, cannot be trusted. Life is dangerous. You go through the airports and so on, and you travel from country to country, and you are subjected to a lot of searching and rigorous searching by those security personnel in order to ensure that there's some measure of safety that can be guaranteed for those travelers, whether you travel by air, land, or sea. It is a very dangerous world to live in. But in spite of the dangers that we are associated with and we are accustomed with, and so on, life goes on. We are here. We have to live with what is before us, And this particular man, as he journeyed, this lurking dangers and so on that he was faced with, you might say he was obviously reckless and foolhardy and things like that, because of the fact that he knew that he wasn't supposed to carry things of value, that were of much value, and going by himself. And sometimes, you know, in life, we take risk. Sometimes, you know, we operate on the basis that I could handle this particular situation. And sometimes it is reckless, you know, when you know for a fact that there's danger ahead and you did not prepare yourself sufficiently well enough to deal with those dangers. And let me very early set out in terms of this message to say that it is a very dangerous situation. It is a very reckless thing to do, to traverse this world without Jesus Christ alongside you. It is very dangerous. Many have tried to do it, and all to their demise. And as we see with this particular man that Jesus is speaking of, we see how reckless and foolhardy this man's character was as he attempted to do as he did, not really attempted, as he did what others would seldom do on that particular road that he was carrying all those valuables and traversing. There are persons, you know, who pass by and, having seen the particular situation that he finally found himself in when he was beaten and left half dead. Thanks be unto God that he was not a dead man. He was left half dead. But you know what is happening? As it relates, you know, to our spiritual condition, if you are out of Christ, you are worse than this man, because you're actually dead. And you need divine intervention to take you out of that state of deadness and to bring you into a position of life. So that the word of God tells us that because of sin, we were born in sin and we are shapen in iniquity. In sin did our mothers conceive us, and we have started off from our very first day upon this face of the earth to go away from God and head into a lost eternity in a state of deadness. As far as God is concerned, you are alive, yes, because you are breathing the breath of life, but you are dead in trespasses and sin if you are not saved, if you are not born again. And this is a very dangerous situation to remain in. This is a very reckless situation to be remaining when it is that God has given all that is necessary to ensure that you can be delivered from such a situation through his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And so this Good Samaritan, as he came by, unlike the others who went before, who would have used the opportunity maybe just to show, you know, their real true character, to the expert in the law, the wounded man was a subject to discuss. To the robbers, the wounded man was someone to use and exploit. To the religious men, the wounded man was a problem to be avoided. To the innkeeper, this wounded man was a customer to serve for a fee. To the Samaritan, the wounded man was a human being worth being cared for and to be loved. To Jesus, most importantly, to all of them, to all of us, as far as Jesus is concerned, this is a soul that is worth dying for. And this is what is important, my friends, this morning. You are important to God in spite of your situation. So that the Levite and the priest, who you expect to do differently, they passed by on the other side and so on and looked at the man and left him alone. The Samaritan, good man, he did something. So that we look at the condescension of the Good Samaritan. He came where this man was. Unlike those who passed by on the other side, in like manner, Christ came where we are. And he has come for that specific purpose, to help us out of our conditions that no one else could help us or deliver us from. He came to our humanity, Jesus Christ, and took it upon himself. He came to our humanity, and he took it upon himself because he became human like us in order to help us. And that is supported in Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 14. Like as we have partaken of flesh and blood, he himself likewise shared in the same. That is the Lord Jesus Christ. He came to our sorrow and became acquainted with it. Sin is that which has caused our world to be sorrowful from way back in Genesis, when the first murder was committed, or when sin was committed, man became sorrowful, Adam and Eve, because they lose that contact, that communication with God, and it brought sorrow, no doubt, so that even in that state and condition that our parents found themselves in, and consequently, life thereafter would have brought sorrow upon the human race, God had a plan to ensure that Jesus Christ, his Son, was going to come to deal with the sin question and the consequences of sin. He came to our sorrow and became acquainted with it, is what Isaiah chapter 53 and verse 4 tells us. Surely he had borne our grief and carried our sorrows, is what the word of God tells us. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted, and so on. So that he came to identify with us. He came to our death, and he died it. That is in 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse 18. For Christ also suffered once for sin. He the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God. He came to our sin, and he bore it. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 21. For he made him who knew no sin, that is God made him Christ, that is who knew no sin, to be made sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. So that Jesus Christ was not a sinner. But God allowed him to bear the sins of the whole world, including yours and mine. He took it upon himself, the weight and burden of sin, in order that he can deal with the sin question. And why it is that God has chosen him to do that? Because he was the one who was well qualified, the one that was only qualified to deal with that sin question, to bear it in his own body upon the cross for you and for me, and to set us free. So that he came to bear our sin. He came to our curse, and not only he came to our curse, but he passed through our curse. He passed through our curse, and that is given for us in Galatians chapter 3 and verse 13. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us. He came for our woe, and endured it. Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 2. Who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is now set down at his Father's right hand. He came to our lowness and to lift us out of it. This man was wounded and he was left on the ground to die. The Samaritan, I believe, was a very strong man because he had to bend down and you have to lift him up and put him on his donkey in order to give the assistance that he needed. And that took great effort. And it reminds me of the effort that it took for the Lord Jesus Christ to come to this earth for you and for me. A lowly step. Yes, he was God in heaven. Yes, three in one. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Part of the Godhead. And he saw our state and condition. We were helpless, lost, and undone because of sin. And Jesus Christ left heaven's glory and came to this sin-cursed earth. Such was the lowly step that he took in order to lift us out. The psalmist said, he brought me out of the miry clay and out of that pit. And he set my feet upon a rock and he has established my goal. In Philippians chapter 2 and verse 8 says, being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. What a step. What a lowly step the Lord Jesus Christ took, like as this Samaritan. And we are thankful this morning that even though, as Isaiah said of him, that it took the shoulders, or it took, sorry, the shoulder of the Lord Jesus Christ, verse 1, to deal with the governments of this day, the past government, present government, and all the governments that will come, it only took one shoulder. It only takes one shoulder of the Lord Jesus Christ to deal with the governmental affairs. Because he it is who puts up and take it down. Let us not lose sight of that. Isaiah spoke of that prophetically. But it says of him, the government shall be upon his shoulder. But when it comes to the salvation of a soul, your soul and mine, it took the shoulders of the Lord Jesus Christ. It took more effort. When he went to look for that sheep that went astray, speaking of what it is that it takes in terms of effort, the Lord Jesus Christ said that having found that sheep, he put it upon his shoulders and bring it back into the fold. And that is the effort that Christ took upon the cross of Calvary in order to bring about our redemption and to purchase for us a salvation that no one else can provide. Such is the condescension of the Lord Jesus Christ. He thought it not robbery to equal with God. He made himself of no reputation, but he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. But thanks be unto God that God has highly exalted him. Having accomplished that work that God has given him to do, God has highly exalted him and has given him a name that is above every name. It is at the name of Jesus that every knee would bow and every tongue would confess, in acknowledging and in confessing that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. What a mighty Savior. We are thankful this morning that, like the Good Samaritan, he condescended. He came to where you are. Jesus Christ has stooped very low to where you are in your sin-sick condition in order to give the assistance and the deliverance that he alone can give. Secondly, you notice in that verse the compassion of the Samaritan, which is equivalent to the Lord Jesus Christ's compassion as well. He had compassion on him. The others who came by had no compassion. They just viewed him, as we noticed before, the various views that they took of this particular man that was left there, half dead and ready to die. But the Samaritan, he had compassion. There was a concern, there was a care that was expressed by him. So that repeatedly we read of Christ being moved with compassion in his life. But the compassion of his compassion was when he took pity upon us as he saw us in our sin. Ezekiel chapter 16 and verse 8 says, God's love to Jerusalem. When I passed by you again and looked upon you, indeed, your time was a time of love. So I spread my wings over you and covered your nakedness, is what God said of his people, the Israelites, in days of old. God of compassion. Compassion is a scarce word today. For those who are in the hot spots, as you might want to say, and those who at the mercy of criminals. Sometimes you wonder what it is that will cause a man to want to pump, you know, as much as 40 bullets into an individual. Even after the first one would have done what it is that they wanted to do in the first place, which is to kill a person. But you're pumping 40. No compassion, no care, no love. This is a world of hate for God and for his creatures. But we are thankful this morning that we have a God who is full of compassion. Full of compassion. And so, in spite of our sinful condition, in spite of our sin-sick soul and so on, Jesus Christ has us at heart. He has our best interests at heart. Romans chapter 6 and verse 8 confirms that. Because he died on our account. So that as even David, as we heard a bit of him this morning, had compassion on Mephibosheth and brought him to his own house according to 2 Samuel chapter 9, when he asked if there's any that is left of the house of Jonathan that I might show mercy and grace and favor and kindness unto him, Mephibosheth was sent for, who was left of Jonathan's household. And David caused him to eat at his table continually, in spite of the fact that Saul wanted to kill him. As far as that lineage is concerned, David could have said, okay, well, now it's time to get even. I'm on the throne now, and let me get even by wiping out all of Saul's household. But because of the friendship that he had with Saul's son, Jonathan, he wanted to show favor for Jonathan's sake. When he came to the throne, David, that is when he became king, he said, listen, I'm going to show mercy and kindness and favor in spite of the hatred that was meted out to me by that man's grandfather. And this is what we call grace. This is what is evidence in terms of the grace of God, the compassion of God. As we see in David towards Mephibosheth, so Christ had compassion on us in dying to meet our need. We are thankful this morning that in spite of our sin-sick condition, bloodied and stained by sin, Jesus Christ has stooped very low, and he hugs us, he loves us, and he wants us to come to him willingly, submissively, not by compulsion. He asks you, he begs of you this morning, if any man lacks, if you want rest, you want joy, you want satisfaction, come to me this morning, he said, and you're going to experience that rest, that joy, that satisfaction that this world cannot give and it cannot take away. So that the Good Samaritan, we see so much wonderful things in this man. And we see lastly, the care of the Good Samaritan. There were 7 things about this Good Samaritan that we want to see as well in these verses that we have looked at. The Good Samaritan did so many things to this man, and some of which is mentioned in the Word of God here, and I just want to develop on it a bit. He went to him. He went to the man. He did not send a deputy. I believe that he could have probably sent someone else. He could have passed and said, okay, listen, I'm going where I'm going, and when I get to where I'm going, I'm going to send back somebody to help you. But he responded immediately. He responded immediately. And so with Christ as well. He responded immediately to all needs. And he has not sent a deputy. He did not send an angel. He did not send the Holy Spirit to save us. Jesus Christ came himself. He saves, yes, embodied in the salvation of God is the work of the Holy Spirit, God himself and God his Son. But Jesus Christ, as Savior, as the one decreed by God for salvation and for the purpose for which we speak this morning, his purpose, his mandate was to save all that come unto God through him. 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 9 says, who saved us and called us with a holy calling? Salvation is of the Lord. And we are thankful this morning that it is the Lord's business to save. He has not given that to me, nor to anyone else in this meeting. In spite of the fact that there are those of us who have experienced God's salvation, we cannot save anyone. We can only point you to the Lord Jesus Christ, because it is in him alone that salvation can be found. Because he alone has the power, the qualifications as far as God is concerned to save. That is the Savior appointed by God. This Samaritan, he was a person who was able to bound up the wounds of this man. But before we go on to that, let me just say a few more things in relation to the Lord Jesus Christ with the salvation here. Is that the Samaritan, as we look at him in relation to Christ, he gives of time and energy and resources. John chapter 14 and verse 27 says, "My peace I leave with you, my peace I give with you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you." That is the Lord Jesus Christ who has come to give peace. Right? So he gave time, peace. He sustains, Isaiah 41 and verse 10. And what that verse says, "Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Yes, I will help you. I will uphold you by the righteousness or with my righteous right hand." He sustains. He accompanies. Exodus 33 and verse 14. "My presence will go with you, and I will give you rest," is what was said to Moses by God when he was appointed to lead God's people. He was given words of assurance that "my presence will go with you." So that Jesus Christ, when he saves you, he accompanies you. You are not left alone. This is the assurance that he has given in his word. "I will never leave you nor forsake you." And this Samaritan, he also would have assured this man to whom he was rendering help and assistance, "I will accompany you. I will take you to the inn so that you can get the help that you deserve that I can't give." Probably wasn't trained in first aid and all those things, and so he didn't have the medical, you know, skills as Sister Jennifer and others would have had or would have or have. So you took him to the inn where he's going to get the kind of care. He keeps. Jude 24. He's able to keep from stumbling. When you come to the Lord Jesus Christ, you don't have to be careful and to be worrying about if it is that I stumble, what is going to happen? Every believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, let us not fool ourselves. Every one of us stumble every day of our lives, in thoughts, in words, and in deeds. But the word of God assures us that there's forgiveness with God, that he should be feared.
Thank you for viewing today's broadcast, Moments with Truth. We want to invite you to call us at 796-0979 or 283-2222. Or you can email us at afrob64@gmail.com. If you look on the screen, you will see our various locations and the times of our services. Be free to attend. A welcome awaits you at all times.